Hey everybody, it's Eddie J on Crypto for GrowMyBag.tv. There is a lot going on, as you might suspect. Now, what's going on? So, Runes Protocol is about to drop. It's about to hit the market, and everybody is asking the same question. How will this affect BRC20 development? We won't know until it happens, so I'm definitely looking into that. Now, the reason why it's such a big deal is because there's been a lot of BRC20 development going on. I know a couple of companies that are involved in that. I know a couple of companies that are sponsors, developers, got their own projects, all that good stuff, and investors. So BRC20 is quite popular. The question that becomes, Runes Protocol is all about tokenization, which brings in that whole real world aspect. So I'm wondering which one is actually going to wind up taking off. It could very much wind up being Runes. OKX launches XLayer. In case you don't know what XLayer is, look at Base. Look at Base by Coinbase. It's basically the same thing. OKX decided, wait a minute, Base has theirs and Base is doing really well with memes. Let's introduce our own, base it on Ethereum, and introduce them to a whole new world of dApps and everything that they can play with. That's going to be interesting. I think their X layer being based on Ethereum is going to be an advantage for them. Directly on Ethereum as opposed to roundabout way. What else is going on? Hong Kong, now this is interesting. Hong Kong had approved those Bitcoin and Ethereum spot ETFs. However, what really happened is, yeah, they got approved. Don't know how many are actually up and running. Third, China's kind of putting the kibosh on it, not killing it totally, but limiting access from mainland China, which means that you're going to have the other Asian countries trying to get involved. And my question is, well, would Singapore get involved? Singapore's got its own, you know, financial hub. They might be working on things. So it's going to be interesting to see how that actually plays out, because Hong Kong really is trying to become Asia's biggest crypto hub. Just look around at the deals and everything that's happening. I mean, HSBC is the leader in tokenization in Hong Kong. And you could possibly even say the world at the moment. So you've got to be paying attention to what's going on with tokenized assets and things like that. So that's what I'm paying attention to, is how does that all affect all of these underlying things? How do they affect everything else, right? Because I'm all about my bag, right? What else is going on? Bitcoin miners. Now, we all know that Bitcoin miners did not do all that well in 2022. They took it on the chin. But funny enough, they're all seeming quite upbeat, right? 2024, they're all sounding upbeat, but you want to know what else they're thinking about? Think about mergers and acquisitions. That's what they're thinking about. So there could be some M&A in that space. And a lot of those miners are publicly traded. So it would be interesting to see, well, what does Marathon do? What does Riot do? What does Hut 8 do? These are the things that, you know, again, underlying things that can affect the broader market. This is why I do research every day. This is why I bring it to you guys, so you guys can get an understanding of what's going on, what can affect my bag, kind of removing the noise, right? We don't need noise. We don't need FUD, but bringing you the facts and then telling you how I feel about those facts. What other facts do I have today? Let me give you some names first. Barclays, Lloyds of London, Citigroup, Mastercard, and Visa. What do they all have in common? Well, they all have in common a pilot program that they're launching to integrate crypto and blockchain into traditional banking services. You know how I've been telling you how banks have to take a step back and rethink what banking is? Well, there you go. That's what they're doing. I'm sorry, my hands feel dry. So that's what they're doing right now, is they're saying, well, we're going to integrate this into traditional banking and we're going to see how that plays out. I'm sitting here and I'm kind of saying to myself, huh, that's interesting. That's very interesting, right? The reason why it's interesting is because all of these banks, well, I'm not going to say all of them, but a couple of these banks, you know, you could say, they could use some help. I'm not saying they're doing poorly. I'm just going to say they could use some help. So if you're going to integrate, and they do more traditional banking, as opposed to the investment banks that are out there that do straight up investment banking, right? So I'm sitting here and I'm saying to myself, wow, that could be very interesting depending on what they're integrating, how they're integrating, and then how they would introduce that to the market. So right now, it's a pilot program with all of them. And I'm not going to leave out the credit cards, MasterCard and Visa. Think about this. What place do MasterCard and Visa really have in a crypto world? They introduce credit, right? And for those of you that want to go back to using credit and living beyond your means and not saving and not being able to invest, and that's something you could do. One of the things that I really love about crypto is that using your crypto wallet to purchase anything, you are absolutely, you know, paying an equivalent of cash. So you can't spend what you ain't got. That's where MasterCard and Visa come in, because they would enable you to do that. I think we all need to get away from that. It's my own humble opinion. I tell my kids the same thing. If you don't have the cash, don't buy it. Don't live beyond your means, right? Budget based on what you have. Budget based on what you've got right now, right? And what you know you have coming in can be said, well, I can earmark that when it gets here. I can earmark that for right now. And then when it gets here, then I'll go do what I said I was going to go do. That's budgeting. Unfortunately, we don't teach that. I don't think we do a good job teaching budgeting. We need to get back to that. So if we were to get back to that, well, people would start living beyond their means. People would start being able to understand how far their dollar can or cannot go, or how far their assets can and cannot go. And they would be vested in themselves. Right? That's what I'm teaching my kids is, listen, that costs $10. You only have $5. Get it next week. You get paid, get it next week. It'll still be there. And then the question becomes, do you really want it? A lot of times when we walk in the stores, oh, I really want that. You wait a week. And then, I really don't need it. Keep it moving. Take that money that you were going to spend and invest it. Go get yourself a hard asset. Boom. Go put it towards something that's going to make you money. That's why I pay attention to this stuff. So Barclays, Lloyds, Citigroup, MasterCard, Visa being involved in this whole pilot program to introduce crypto and blockchain technologies into traditional finance, I'm highly interested, one, in what, you know, integrations are going to do, two, how they're going to market those integrations, because nothing's come out. It's just, this is what we're working on, but nothing specific, right? And that's what I'm paying attention to. What is it? Define it. So I think in a little while, we'll start to see the fruits of their labor. But I think there might still be going through the wranglings of, well, what does that mean for, you know, cross firm interactions? How are we going to work with Visa and MasterCard? You know, all that stuff. Because what they don't want to happen is they don't want assets under management, meaning the bank deposits. They don't want those to go down. And I told you, I've been telling you for a while that's a big thing that could happen, because instead of keeping the bulk of my money in a bank, I can have the bulk of my money making me money elsewhere. Back in the day, you had to have enough money to know a trader to get your money traded, to be in the stock market, all that other stuff. Right now, I could be sitting in the tub soaking and be doing investing right there from my phone. I no longer need or require that person. I can do it all electronically right there. And that's what's really going on. The world of investment has changed, and what you can invest in has also changed. You're looking at a lot of things where people are wondering, well, should I be worried about getting involved in, let's say, I don't know, real estate, commercial real estate within a city? Back in the day, that was what you wanted to do. Now, not so much. Not so much, right? Because big cities, you know, some cities are coming back and other cities are not. So you're paying attention to what you want to invest in, where you want to invest in, all those other good things. But right now, the data that's at your fingertips to actually get your hands on assets, right? Assets instead of stuff. Stuff doesn't earn you money. Assets earn you money. Just putting it out there for you so you can get a better understanding of what I'm talking about. What else is going on? There's a potential iMessage exploit that's led Trust Wallet to issue a warning. And I think it has to do with, you could receive an iMessage, receive a, you know, a link, click it, and it opens up and can cause a transaction in Trust Wallet. So we'll see what happens with that. Let me see if I can get some more information. Give me one sec. It's a $2 million iMessage exploit, iPhone takeover possible without clicks. Whoa, without clicks. Urges iMessage disable iMessage amid $2 million exploit. That's big. To take over your iPhone without a click? Yeesh. And that would mean that I can get into your crypto wallets. That's a problem. I'm going to have to do some more research on that one. There's been no confirmation from Apple about it. No confirmation whatsoever. But that could be a very big deal. But this is one of the reasons why you should be up and at it with regard to your cybersecurity. Very big deal. Because something like that, a zero click, that's basically a zero knowledge attack. I don't have to click on anything. I just get an iMessage and open iMessage and boom, there it is. That's scary. That's very scary. So I'm hoping Apple comes out with something about that. So what else is going on in the world? Upbit is dominating South Korea as far as centralized exchanges are concerned. However, BitThumb and others are creating a price war to try to take back some of that market share. So there's a big price war going on in South Korea. So there's something to pay attention to. I'm just wondering, like, you know, if I'm considering that there's going to be M&A all over the place, right? Could there be M&A in the centralized exchange space? That would be interesting. Here's something else that I find interesting. If these banks are looking to implement integrate crypto and blockchain technologies into traditional finance, what does that mean? Because that could mean, well, could they become exchanges? And I have to tell you, to be honest with you, I don't know that I'd be going for that. And the reason why is because to be a centralized exchange, and they're already highly regulated, and they already have problems, I don't know if that's something I'm interested in. So do your research before you jump in bed with these companies, these banks that are integrating blockchain and, you know, other technologies with regard to crypto. I'm going to be highly skeptical. I want to know, how are you regulated? What is it affecting? How does it affect my money? Am I going to earn money? Am I not going to earn money? What each player is doing is what I'm going to be concerned about. Anyway, you know what we should do? We should get into the numbers. And again, I didn't have my watermark. It's so bad. I need to turn that on immediately. I need to do that immediately. That's horrible of me. Let me refresh this data so that we can see what's brand new and popping. There you go. So we don't have a lot going on the positive side. OKB, OKX, is up 7%. I have no idea what core is. I haven't done any research on it. It's not within my parameters just yet. Nobody's asked me about it. That's what that means. But everybody's on the downside. So let's see. D-Gen, Pups is down. Pups has been, this is the second day, I think, Pups has been down in a row. Same thing with Helium, second day in a row, it's been down. Nervous Network had been up a lot. Now it's down 18%. I mean, they were up a lot. Look at their year-to-date earnings. They're still up year-to-date. I think it was like 500% plus when I looked at it yesterday. Dog with Hat, down 17%. Again, I'm trying to pay attention to that sway and pay attention to the rhythm of some of these meme coins. Bonk, Jitto takes a hit 16%. Bonk takes a hit 16%. Immutable takes a hit 15%. I think that's definitely a buying opportunity. I like Immutable. I've always liked Immutable. Bitcoin Cash took a hit 14%. Again, I'm looking at that and I'm thinking, that could be a good thing. That could be money for me. That could definitely be money for me. Sci Network down 14%. Lido Staked Sol is down 14%. BitTensor down 14%. Oof, nothing pretty. We do have some banks coming out with their numbers this week. We also had United Health come out with their numbers earlier today. They seem to be on a beat, so they're on the positive side. We have Bank of America, Johnson & Johnson, big on the, you know, in the medical device, and obviously pharma space. Morgan Stanley is coming out with their numbers. Bank of New York Mellon, PNC Financial. So here's something funny about Morgan Stanley. Again, Morgan Stanley, their wealth crew, is being investigated. So that's something I'm going to be paying attention to. But these numbers are previous to that. The next numbers are going to be hit with that. So I'm going to be paying really, really good attention to that. We don't need that one. Let's see. Today is Tuesday. What's going on today? We get housing starts, building permits. Fed Vice Chair Jefferson is going to speak. Let's see, what do we have going on later down the week? We have the Beige Book coming out, Cleveland Fed President, Fed Governors talking as well. Thursday, we get manufacturing numbers, more Fed talk, U.S. leading economic indicators. That's going to be interesting to pay attention to. And then Friday, we get nothing. There's nothing on Friday. That's it. Just another Fed speaking. But these are all good things to pay attention to. Why? Because they're all economic numbers. Ooh, fear and greed index drops tremendously from 74 down to 65. Expected, right? We've had a lot of bad news. Israel saying that we will respond when the time is right doesn't put everything to bed. It still says that there's more to come. Middle East has never been an easy place. And it's continuing to prove so. DeFi Llama, we're down to $110 billion assets, you know, total value locked. Not bad, not great. And for this one, look at this. We're currently at 62,683. We're back within my blue band, which is from 57,686 to 63,14. So now we're operating at a much lower level than we had been over here. And over here. And over here. So really, if you really look at it, we're basically moving sideways when you really stop and think about it. Wow, that's interesting. Now, we haven't seen 60 since about March 24th, give or take. And that was 60,824 or around there. That's interesting because right now, you know, our lows are in the 62, 61 range. And I said, I think 60 is going to be our floor. I think 60 has been established as our new floor. So can we see a drop again? It's possible, right? It's possible we could see that with Bitcoin miners, you know, taking profits, things like that after the halving event. Remember, the halving event is a catalyst, but it's not an immediate catalyst. It'll take a minute for everything to start to happen. And then you'll see everything start to go up. So it takes a minute. It's not an immediate thing. It's not like, you know, we got a whole bunch of, you know, Bitcoin spot ETFs that happened and now money's flowing in. Remember, we still have downward pressure because of basically grayscale. Most of it is because of grayscale. Some people are going to point at Israel, but I want you to look at everything that happened between Israel and Iran. We took a dive, but not that much of a hit. We're kind of sustaining, and I think we're sustaining because of all that buy-in. Again, most people don't have their foundational understanding of crypto. They just get in and because they think everybody else is doing it, so I'm going to do it too. Get that education. Get that education. You can get it by getting my book, Crypto Foundations for Building Multi-Generational Wealth. Have it in hardcover and paperback. Just go to Amazon. You can snatch it right up. Looking at the big board, what are we seeing? Nothing but big red. Nothing but big red. Now, if you're seeing blood like we are right now, what I'm thinking is, for me, buying opportunities. I'm seeing too many things on sale. I'm going to have to, you know, control myself with buying a whole bunch of stuff. But again, I'm not buying anything until after the halving event. Why? Because we took a dip larger than this already, and I already bought it. And I already took advantage at this level. So I'm paying attention to what's after the halving event. Are we going to take another dip? Are we going to start to rise? I have money on sitting on the side looking at that. So what else is going on? Looking at the numbers going straight across the board, now is when I'm starting to pay attention to year to date and the numbers after that. Why? Because it's going to help me figure out what I want to buy next. Now, this is horrible. Cardano's been horrible. Horrible, horrible, horrible. But that means to me that coin is due to go up. After the halving event and everything starts going well, I think Cardano is due to actually rise. Something else I'm paying attention to. Shiba Inu up 2.24% from where I bought it off of that dip. Let's see where Solana is. Solana is still up, you know, from where I bought it after that dip or during that previous dip. Same thing for Bitcoin Cash. Now, I wanted to pick up some Chainlink, but I was like, you know what? I'm going to chill right here. Why? Because I think it's going to go a little bit lower and I'll get in then. So that's what I'm paying attention to. Anyway, this is Eddie J on Crypto for growmybag.tv. I hope you like what I'm doing. If you do, drop me a note, send a thanks, send me a sticker, send something, send me smoke signals. Let me know you like what I'm doing. If you don't like what I'm doing and you think that, or you like it and you still think that I have, you know, some improvement to do, let me know. I want to always improve. Remember, I'm not just delivering to you. I'm delivering to my kids too. And sorry, Stitch didn't, you know, stop by. He was going for a walk. Anyway, everybody, I hope you have a good one. Bye-bye.